If you're a Java developer, you're probably using a fancy IDE and a build tool, including libraries, compiling, and packaging your application is taken care of. But what happens when you press the green run button? Today, we're going to unravel some of that magic. Let's start with the basics. How do we compile and run something? We can use Java C to compile and Java to invoke the JVM. What if we wanted to structure our code? We have a calculator that we would like to use in the main class. So, could we run this? Well, no. When a class is referenced directly and not imported, the compiler will look for it in the same directory. So let's fix it and give it another try. Still no. What could seem a bit strange is that we could compile the calculator separately, and this works just fine, but compiling the main class still won't work. To really understand this, we have to talk about fully qualified class names. A fully qualified class name is simply the class name prefixed with the package. One of the many tools shipped with the JDK is the class disassembler, JavaP. If we use it on the calculator, we can see that the fully qualified class name is just the class name, which makes sense because we didn't declare a package. So let's change that, recompile the file, and it now has a new name. So whether at runtime or compile time, Java is only concerned with these. It also expects every class to reside in a folder corresponding to the package name. So in the previous example, when Java saw this, it was looking for a class MathCalculator in the math folder, but since it was compiled without a package declaration, it couldn't find it. Now that we have fixed our code, we could finally run it. What if we had even more calculators that we would like to use in future projects? We could of course copy over the files each time, but if you would want to distribute your software, you would have to archive it somehow to allow for single file downloads. And in the Java world, we use Java archives. First, let's create a folder where the compiled classes will go to, then compile, specifying that directory. We can now invoke the jar command to create our archive. A jar is really just a zip file, and we could use the zip info command to inspect it. We can see that a new file was added, manifest.mf, and then there is the math folder containing all the classes. The manifest file provides metadata about the archive, such as the name and the version. Or, if we had a whole runnable application, we could specify the main class. Or maybe you want to seal a package, ensuring all of its classes are defined in the archive. We could now use the library quite easily by modifying the class path, which we will be covering soon. So jars are an extension of zip files, and if I were to extract the files and instead zip them, we could compile and run the app just fine. So what's the CP flag we just used? It's used to specify the class path, which is simply places where Java looks for classes. Whether when compiling or running the application. By default, the class path consists of just the current working directory, but we could specify many such places, as well as jars, like we did previously. When passing in the class path, each path is separated by a colon, or a semicolon if you're on Windows. If we go back to the previous example, when we tried to use the calculator without a package declaration and no imports, we could actually make this all work by modifying the class path. You shouldn't do this, of course, but it demonstrates the power of the class path. So hopefully these basics, which I think are often overlooked, are really clear to you now. Thanks for watching.